Normally the people are saying, oh my God, again, some young, diverse guy was standing here in front talking about the importance of diversity and inclusivity, or how all those diverse people stand with each other and like are happy, and that the diverse and inclusive environment is something that we all can create. By fact, if you write down on Google, cultural diversity at work, this is the first images you see, happy faces of different colors standing next to each other. But for me, this is not diversity. Diversity is not about the faces of different colors. Diversity is for me not about the buzzword of the media who's saying to us, yeah, we must have more color in boardrooms, we must have more colors in the newspapers. No, diversity is in fact about believing in what you see. What are you seeing now around you? What are you seeing when you go out of this building in the city? What are you seeing in Brussels, Antwerp, London, and more like that? Those things that you are seeing with your own eyes is the diversity that we are living in today, the cultural diversity that we are living in today. In fact, we are moving by numbers from diversity towards super diversity. What means that in Belgium alone, every year there's a growing of cultural diversity by 1%. 1% more cultural diversity here in Belgium. And it's not only about refugee, so I hope there's not one kind of cabinet employee of Theo Franken. It's not about refugees. It's about just people, cultural diverse people who create mixed relationship, coming together, enjoying time together, and having more cultural diversity together. But the reason why I'm so showing you this number is because it's important to focus. If you create a place, just like Philip did in the beginning of building this digitizer building, about, okay, how can we make it inclusive? How can we involve every more than 60% of cultural diversity around here? We are calling those cities now, just as Brussels, Antwerp, Rotterdam, the majority minority cities. What means that the majority who are living in those kind of cities exist of minorities together. If we look to the reality of a lot of startup communities now, if we look to a lot of data communities now, the only diversity that you see is maybe the international diversity. But if you look to the local cultural diversity, they are even not attracted in it. They do not belong in this kind of communities. And that's really sad. Because if you look to our children, I'm still 20, so I don't have a child. But if you look to your child, or your children's, they are sitting now in kindergarten. 70% of the children's now in kindergarten here in Brussels, Antwerp, and Rotterdam has a different ethical background. 70%. So imagine a community place, a place like Digitizer, who's not focusing on this diversity, on this inclusivity. How will it become a future-proof place if the kids of today cannot be a part of the Digitizer of tomorrow? But people, what's the story behind those numbers? Because I can keep talking about the numbers of cultural diversity and how important it is. But just like Philip said, there is a story behind it. And so please allow me to talk about my own story. I am one of these Brusselaars who was born in the Netherlands, refugee with his parents here at the age of 10 in Monenbeek. Really poor, so we were sleeping with three, my brother and sister, on the ground without any money that we can spend. But then at the age of 15, I realized about, okay, I must create something myself here in Brussels. I can go work, because I'm 15 and we know the legal terms here in Belgium, so I can't really go to work. What can I do then? And so I was searching on Google, what can I do as a young guy to become rich, to have money? And the solution was really easy, become an entrepreneur. That was the answer of Google, entrepreneurship, take risk, and all those kind of things. So at the age of 15, I started my first startup, a tech startup, and I was being called the youngest entrepreneur of Belgium. I did get a lot of media attention in Flanders by the royal members, by the ministers, and more like that. But the reason why I'm talking, and now 5 years later, I'm enjoying my life as an entrepreneur. But the reason why I'm telling this, this important story of this 15 years old young guy from Brussels, is because there's a lot more of Hassans here around in this city, maybe the neighbors of digitizers, young guys of 15, of young girls of 15 years old, were saying to themselves, I don't want to live in this poor environment anymore. I don't want to become poor anymore, and I want to do something for myself, something for my own environment, and create something. And then my question is, okay, let's open the door for them. Let's open the door for them to enter here and become the entrepreneurs of their own life. Open also your own doors, the doors of your company to them, and say to them, okay, we want to listen to you. Just to give you a small example, when I had the idea of a startup at the age of 15, I sent it around 20 Belgium companies. I searched the 20 biggest companies of Belgium, and I sent it to their info@ company name, an email about, I have a business idea, and I hope you will help me. No one responded to me. Only one, that's now a client of me, but 5 years ago, and they said, come again when you become 18. And I said, but I'm an entrepreneur now, I have an idea now. Why should I come then? Just to give you an example of young guys like me who want to become an entrepreneur of their own life. And the only 4 things that I needed was place, a place to create something, a place to create some meetings to invite people, because I couldn't do that at home. I didn't have the finance to hire or create my own place. By this place, the second thing that I needed was mentorship. And even Marion de Bruyne, the rector of the decan of Flerik Business School, told me, Hassan, it's not about mentorship, it's about sponsorship. What means that some person, for example, Sofina with Harold Boel with this building, they didn't say, I'm going to mentor you and just like share my knowledge with you. No, I'm going to be your sponsor. What means is I'm going to open the doors that I already have, that I already entered, with you, with the guys, with the girls here around. So that's the second thing that I needed, a mentor, a sponsorship. The third thing was the network. When you have this mentor who's helping you, he's also giving you, or she, the network. And that was so important for me. I don't need to talk about the importance of network, but it is important. So today, when you're gonna network here, and there are some young people who are ashamed to talk with you, just go yourself to them and say, look, what's your idea? Why are you here today? Can I help you with something? Let's have a meeting. Don't say just let's connect on LinkedIn. We all know that. By tonight, we have 100 requests on LinkedIn. No, say we're going to sit together. Let's meet up together. And the fourth thing is the inclusive FFF. All those investors, people know that. Family, friends, fools, who invest, the first investors in your startup, in your idea. Why I'm saying the inclusive part, it's a research by World Economic Forum, who say that the most successful startup founders are children of rich people, or from the middle class people. With one reason, they're allowed to access of money. Because their family can share the first kind of money, the friends can share, or the fools can share. But for me, as a young 15-year-old boy who's like sleep on the ground, my family don't have the money. My friends are like maybe even poorer than me. And I didn't have the network who could share with me the money. So that's the reason why I'm saying the inclusive FFF. Let's create some kind of new family friends who want to invest in your first idea. We want to invest with a small amount. So the question that I always say, do you want to become a ladder or a limbo as a company or as an individual? Do you want to give me a ladder to go higher every time? Or do you want to be the limbo that says, do you know you have a great idea? But first send me an email with all your, let us say, ID, your name and your date of birth and all that. That's the limbo. That's of, I am here and I have this idea. But they bring you like there. They demotivated you. So become the ladder. Those are also the stories of our cities, people. If you go now on the street, for example, now I'm an entrepreneur myself. So I have a consultant company who's focusing on inclusive customer and employee journey. But next to it, what I said at the age of 18, I think, was, okay, I have now my own network. I get a lot of media attention. I want to share it myself with my friends because I'm still studying. So the friends were with me in the class. And that's the reason we created a seat at the table. A seat at the table is an organization, no profit organization, well known in Flanders, not so known in Wallonia, the reality of Belgium. So well known, a seat at the table is an organization where we create the opportunity for youngsters to only sit with a CEO or a C-level of a company. So it's a board, boardroom where they sit together. The CEO talks about his experiences or her experiences and what they did and how they become the C-level of today. And then after, the youngsters can ask some questions. And what we discovered that every meeting table, every round table that we create, we have 20 youngsters that come. We have a community of more than 1,000 youngsters. But in every round table, 20 youngsters come and visit the round table. And from those 20, there are always two who stay with the CEO for an internship, a student job, or more like that. We are really happy that the past month we even went to New York with those disadvantaged youngsters from Brussels. We went to New York with 30 youngsters. We visited Boston Consulting Group, Salesforce, all those kind of companies, just to give them an opportunity. Because the faces of our society, what we are seeing here tonight, or maybe when we go out, are not those faces that we are seeing on the newspaper of youngsters who don't want to become something or are lazy or are just here to destroy something. No, the youngsters are here to become something themselves, but they need you. They need the help of you all. Digitizer is also already providing this help, but I hope that you all also will provide the help, because let us be honest, what's more beautiful than just an inclusive place to work in and an inclusive network to have from. Thanks for everything.